Welcome everyone. It's an honor to have all of you on this next subject. And this is a subject of such importance and such relevance today that Naredco along with Kushman decided to hold this event at this. It was a good effort and thank you, Saurav, for doing all the work and coordinating with this, Sumit, and making this possible. Well, COVID has changed the entire scenario, the way we live, the work and all that. And suddenly if COVID was to go today, we are not going to go back to the norms. The work from home is going to be there. The our way we work, the flexi offices, all of that going to stay. Same is for living, the way we live, and how thoroughly they are going to change. And this is the environment that this whole COVID has offered us. It has offered us so much of problems, but it has given us opportunity to reinvent ourselves and this. And whatever we say, these two innovations of the new asset class of co-living and co-working are going to be the thing of the future. And we look forward to understand and learn from today's deliberation how things can be worked out, and especially for our members and the people who are working. See, for any report we see, the whole everything, everyone is so bullish about this, and so many new players are coming into it. And for this, we thought this is the right opportunity to get together all the stakeholders together and deliberate on this. And I'm so happy to have such a galaxy of panelists and keynote speakers that it'll be a real pleasure to listen to all of you, and I'm absolutely looking forward, and so are all our participants. So we have two keynote speakers, Anshul and Niranjan sir. Both of them absolutely need no introduction. So without wasting much time, I'll invite Anshul ji to give us the first keynote address, and then Niranjan sir, and then Saurav will lead the panel discussions with all our distinguished panelists. Before I hand it over to Anshul, just let me thank our supporters, Hiranandani Group, Tata Reality and Jester, for supporting this event, and we look forward to more opportunities for organizing seminars like this. Over to you, Anshul ji.
Thank you so much, Mr. Goyal, and good morning to all the fellow panelists, and welcome to all the listeners out there. You know, it's an interesting topic. 4 million square foot last year was absorbed by the co-working space. And that, I think, if you ask someone around this panel, probably in April, in February, March of last year, when the lockdown had just started, you know, nobody would have predicted that the co-working industry will still grow. I think there was a lot of discussion at the time of consolidation, of perhaps a complete stop for basically co-working or managed workspaces for some time. But, you know, within 2 months, the industry really pivoted. I think credit to, and that's what happens in new age industries, right? Their ability to pivot and do new things is fantastic. And in my mind, I think there was not a quantum difference, but perhaps they sped up stuff, you know, initiatives that were already on way for this particular industry over the previous few years. So the industry, if you remember back in 2014-15, started with co-working operations, and co-working was meant to be for startups, for entrepreneurs, to just occupy a few seats here and there. And soon enough, by 2017-18, there were a number of sort of, you know, players started emerging, which started focusing on enterprise. And I think that's one fundamental change that COVID has brought, which has really pivoted the whole industry towards, significantly towards enterprise, at least in the next kind of 2 or 3 years, as the startups and perhaps the entrepreneurs kind of shrink back into their personal space, in their home space for working. And the need for enterprise, for someone to provide CapEx, for someone to provide design, for someone to provide managed workspaces, which makes corporate's life a lot easier, has sort of, you know, accentuated. And therefore, as I said, 3 or 4 things and on the pivot, I think co-working operators have become providers of CapEx number one, which is a big need for enterprises today. When I say CapEx, it's CapEx into fit outs. So that's kind of number one. Second, which they were already doing, was providers of design, providers of tech-enabled services to create an environment, to manage that environment, which is much more value-added facilities management. And then, of course, the ability to tailor rather than having a standard co-working office, which then the corporate needs to fit in. It's the other way around now. Most companies are moving towards, which is ability to tailor the design and tailor the services for corporate. So as I said, a big pivot into enterprise. The consolidation clearly happened. The top eight players in India continued to sort of grow through last year. As I said, 4 million square foot actually got absorbed last year. Today, between the top eight players, there's circa 26 million square foot of space, which is kind of leased by the top eight players in the co-working industry. There's possibly 400,000 to 500,000 seats which they offer. And I shouldn't call it co-working. It's probably more managed workspaces. That terminology is catching up. So it's more managed workspace industry. And according to the projections that's been put out by top eight players in India, we're looking at another 7 to 8 million square foot of space being added by this industry just in the next 1 year, right? A lot of this would be tripartite transaction. A lot of this would be, having those transactions upfront and then going and creating those deals. But there'll be some speculative space as well, as more and more mid-sized firms also pivot to moving from having their own space where they have the headache of everything to manage workspaces. So that's, so in a nutshell, I think this industry has actually done really well. And that's just not in India. I think in the rest of Asia, we're seeing a huge demand. It's kind of grown fairly rapidly from near 0% in 2015 within 5 years. 25, 26 million just in the top eight players, and then you add everything else, it probably goes up to about 35, 40 million square foot. That's almost 8% of India's grade A supply, which is pretty good going. And if we forecast it, I don't think, I think this industry will only, go forward faster, at a faster clip as we move forward. And, the pivots that the shrewd operators have kind of gone in pretty quick and will help them in expediting this industry. Now, just moving to co-living for a minute again, co-living actually depends a lot on, and a lot of people actually wrote off co-living given the norms for social distancing, hygiene, just ability to manage. But it's our belief that once the vaccinations are in place, which let's say the world is going through that process this year and maybe big part of next year. I think the social distancing and the health, the current concerns will kind of reduce. The return to office will be a big driver of co-living. We're seeing that in the US as the vaccinations have progressed, the return to offices have started. People have started coming back from wherever they were working from the hometown, from the parents' place, people have started coming back to main cities. In fact, one of the reports that Cushman & Wakefield put out actually said that in main cities of US, including Chicago, et cetera, the occupancy in co-living was reaching a pre-pandemic level. We're seeing that here in Singapore, occupancy is reaching at sort of the pre-pandemic level. And we're likely to see that in India as well, as the sort of return to office. That's return to office percentage would be a key figure to watch. We all believe, the consensus belief that offices will start kind of functioning with a pretty good capacity by end of this year. And therefore, particularly companies in US have done is they've taken advantage of this kind of downturn and have actually consolidated supply ready for that sort of return to office and therefore the demand sort of coming back in. Another interesting thing happening in the apartment sector in the US, Japan, Australia, is there's a lot of institutional interest in owning blocks of apartments and then leasing it out. So single owner and leasing different apartments out rather than you and I leasing an apartment out from individual landlord. And that is, I think, yeah, you know, is a pretty strong phenomenon. What we feel is that there'll be a lot of, in India, the institutional money will eventually start getting interested in owning apartment blocks from a leasing perspective. And the concepts of co-living will start sort of integrating with your normal leasing normal leasing for them to kind of drive yields. Because ultimately, as the interest rate comes down, which in India right now is a pretty good interest rate environment, you know, your kind of rental yield moves up a little bit, and you can mix co-living concepts like co-living and perhaps, student housing, which is yet another sector, but kind of merges with co-living at the back end. All of that will actually drive the rental yields up. And therefore, again, that's firmly where we see the market heading. Co-living is a few years behind, 2 or 3 years behind where co-working is. But if you see the explosion of co-working, I think explosion in co-living is probably coming in the next kind of few years. So that's really what I'd say, very bullish about both the sectors. I think the next 5 years really belongs to these two sectors. And from a development community, I think a big focus in how do we capitalize on these sectors would be very interesting. Keen to hear what Mr. Hiranandani has to say, and then the panel, of course. Thank you.
Thank you, Anshuji. So over to you, Hiranandani, sir.
Very good morning to each and every one of you. Thank you, Mr. Anshul Jain. That's been very, very good to get an international perspective on the co-living and co-working spaces. I think it's a huge input which I have received. And I kind of concur with him on the direction in which he has already said and made quite a clarificatory points, which I think need to be kept in mind for anybody who wants to work into the space. Let's understand a couple of things. The co-working space picked up in the sense that the investments required by individual corporates were not needed. The individuals were able to get a flexibility in the number of people that we were able to get into a particular space. And when you wanted more space or less space, the co-working space could actually take it. So this was one of the concepts. The second of the concepts of co-working is where you even headquartered your company in a co-working space. So you had the headquarters too, and then you had a part flexibility. That also has been a concept which has started working. And people don't want to go and get a space, work it out, furnish the space, etc., and I want the serviced space ready so that the companies can do the business of business focused on it. So anything from 1 to 20, 20 to 200, 50 to 500 and more started looking at co-working spaces in a more structured way on a long-term perspective. COVID has disturbed all these concepts simply because the companies themselves are not too sure how they are going to do it in the future. So a large number of companies doing co-working are wondering whether working in the co-working space are wondering whether to what extent the changes are going to take place. Hence, it is the duty bound of the co-working creating companies to actually adjust the spaces suitable to what the new needs are. More space per person, other aspects of cleanliness, hygiene, and others need to be flagged off in terms of a different sort of way. I am 100% with Mr. Anshul Jain when he says that the future appears to be extremely strong. And I totally concur with him that that is where the future is going to be, simply because there is no essential need for companies and corporates to want to focus on these spaces when you have a proper professionally managed space and you don't treat the space as an essential. The IT industry also appears to be wanting to go in this direction, but they have not scaled up in this direction. They are still in the old model of they themselves having it. If the IT industry really got into it, you would see a new paradigm happen. But at this point of time, IT industry has not scaled up into this direction. And hence, you are going to see the old school continue in terms of direct rental by companies, as well as the new school in terms of co-working space. Another aspect of co-working space is the hub and spoke model, especially because of the COVID story. Companies do not mind a hub and spoke model. But why do you need a hub and spoke at the moment? One is you don't want to bring everybody to the office, but at the same time, people are unable to work from home. It's okay to talk about working from home. Husband is working, wife is working, two children are studying, four people are doing it, and they're crawling on each other. And it's just not happening to the satisfaction. Even divorces are happening. So you'd rather have another hub and spoke model wherein you could have small spaces, different places closer to the home spaces of that, where you can go like a business center and operate into it on a hub and spoke model. So a co-working spaces at various parts of the city by a single provider with providing necessary connectivity and other things would work as a model, which I think could be flagged off as a major change that is likely to happen in the next couple of years. Of course, the question does come remain as to how many people will work from home. We can keep on debating and debating, and the same companies have given contradictory opinions. In New York, large companies who were saying that 50, 70, 80% people will work from home have already announced that in the next 1 year, they will have 100% come to the office. So you're going to get the strange pendulum wherein large companies will say 75% working from home, 75% working from office, co-working also the hub and spoke model. So all these are going to be tested depending on the type of business, on the type of business of what it is. And you will see who all these models are going to work. But co-working is here to stay. I flag off what Mr. Anshul Jain said, and this is not going to change. I am also equally bullish along with him that these spaces are going to continue to grow. On the co-living space, I think that also is working model that has happened. I know about one of my staff members who had their young son who had got their first job. My staff member stays in Powai in a nice luxurious house, but has a son who has a workplace in Andheri. And all of a sudden the son decided that I'd rather be at the closer to the workspace in Andheri, and took a co-living space over there at Andheri. Now, this was kind of a surprise for both of them. The child who had shifted over here in Andheri and the parent who was there in Powai. So this is a new reality, which means that co-living is also a reality. People at my age group are not able to swallow these ideas as clearly, especially when you want the grandchildren closer to you. Forget the children, you even want the grandchildren next to you. So our thought process is a bit dated, and the youngsters think very differently. So I think co-living is definitely in, and it's certainly not people of the same sex necessarily, but that's another story that I don't want to dwell in at this type of platform. But in reality, what is going to happen is co-living again is going to grow. I flag off what Mr. Anshul Jain said, that yes, it has not grown as strongly as co-working spaces because the structure is not clear and the demand is not very available to all of us. I think once we get demand, one more thing which Mr. Jain hinted to, and I'm going to take that as a more serious model that I think the future will hold, which is student living. Student living as a co-living space or student living in a structured form, my view, is going to be very, very, very big in the next couple of years. Educational institutions are not going to build hostel accommodation in a big way. but they will use people who will have structures to do so. This is available all over the world in next to institutions of merit. And I do believe that we will do that. My own college and institution and university in Mumbai have already tied up with several people for providing hostel accommodation for students in South Mumbai and also in suburbs of Mumbai. We've already started this. Of course, because of COVID, it has not picked up in a very big way. But I do believe that student accommodation, especially in large cities and closer to institutions, is certainly going to be in increasing demand in the next couple of years. So flag off the same points in with different stories to prove the same point. And hence, I concur with Mr. Anshul Jain that it is going to grow. The question, of course, is what is the pace of change that is going to take place? And that's a big question mark, which I don't have an immediate answer. But we have such great panelists over here today. And I'm sure that my unanswered question will be answered by them through before the end of this panel discussion. And I would love to understand what is their guesstimate, if not estimates, of what the figures are going to be in terms of student housing, co-working and co-living spaces as a number where we would have how many in various cities and how much investments are likely to come in during this period. So thank you very much. It's always wonderful to interact with leaders who have thought processes and ears to the ground. So it's beautiful to be here this top of the morning to be on a learning curve. Wonderful, and the weather in Mumbai is wonderful. It's overcast with no rain. So it's nice and cool. So let's enjoy the good weather over here in Mumbai for those who are here. I don't know what it is in Singapore or in Delhi, but it looks better than what it was yesterday. So thank you very much and have a wonderful day today.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. And by the way, just to inform you, Delhi is also very nice today. It's raining. It's very pleasant. Also, thank you very much, sir, for both the keynote addresses. Now it's over to Saurabh to take over with the panel, and we have such a distinguished panel. We all look forward to now learn on this. Thank you, and over to you, Saurabh.
Thank you, Rajesh ji, and thank you, Anshul, and thank you, Dr. Hiranandani, and Dr. Hiranandani, I would remember when you said people are taking divorce. Also, thankfully, I'm not on that side still, but definitely that's a new thing which I heard today. So good morning, everyone. And I'm really excited to be...
Because you're sitting in the office.
thank you, sir. Thank you, Ms. Hiranandani. So good morning, everyone. And I'm really excited to be part of this webinar today. And, today we are discussing the newest asset classes within the real estate business, which is co-working and co-living. And as Dr. Hiranandani mentioned, I also feel is co-living is an extension of rental housing, where it covers not only co-living, it's student housing, industrial housing, and some of the other facets within the rental business. And like Anshul also touched upon, multifamily, which is a very popular business globally. And we are seeing in Asia, Japan, and some of the other countries also coming with a multifamily, which is the future in India as well. And we, you know, today we all are here to see what lies ahead for these asset classes in the new normal. And these asset classes have paved a new path for themselves. And in the last 3 to 5 years, I would say, and moving away from conventional real estate, you know, by way of, let's say, they all are targeting the millennial population, bringing a very large play of technology, another avenue of the traditional way of rental income, very extremely flexible tenures, and also minimal capital requirement. You know, some of the salient features of all these asset classes which are part of the rental. As far as co-working is concerned, you know, as Anshul mentioned, it is growing at a rapid pace, and you know, co-working operators leasing the highest number ever in terms of the area since 2018. And this was, as I said, this was largely driven by millennial workforce and the growing startup ecosystem and the greater ease in setting up offices without any administrative hassles. It was obvious that the co-working spaces would be hit by the lockdown. You know, however, the same lockdown gave a rise to an evolution in the way one works, as we were hearing from Anshul as well as Dr. Hirandani. Individuals and companies suddenly were looking for flexible spaces at various locations, like Dr. Hirandani said, hub and spoke model within the city, and slowly returned to offices. And these co-working places started seeing revival of their demand coming back. The workplace evolved from being purely functional to being more productive, more experiential, and meaningful. And companies did not want to make long-term commitments and did not want to pay for fit-outs upfront, but looking for integrated solutions. This in turn made the pandemic-led businesses to reevaluate their commercial real estate strategy to make it more resilient and agile to adapt to these changes. The post-lockdown scenario, which is what we are discussing, is bringing in a wave of new opportunities for the co-working operators and owners. Co-working spaces are now witnessing traction and robust operations. While the work from home model would have worked well in the lockdown, many companies may not want to be as a culture, and many business verticals and functions still require employees to work in an office setting. Work from home may coexist, but office space will not lose its importance. Now more than ever, flexibility is crucial, and hence co-working spaces or managed spaces with their inherent readiness to add value are best positioned to adapt and redefine the future of work and workspace. As far as co-living is concerned, currently, as you know, India is home to around 440 million millennial population in absolute terms. And, millennials comprising around 40% of India's total population. Migrant bachelors have been long be used to taking up space in rented accommodation. And I'm also talking a bit on student housing as well. And, on sharing basis or traditionally staying as PG and all that stuff. However, the process of renting spaces offered to choose from have been scattered and very unorganized. So millennials who move out of their cities in search of good education or job opportunities are bogged down by rising rents and shrinking pockets. Students and young working professionals are not keen on sharing their space with these old-time landlords or to be burdened by regular tasks like doing their house chores and all other stuff. The shared living market solves this need for independence and takes over the day-to-day task of managing a house or a place where you live. All this paved the way for a more organized and professionally managed system called co-living, or on a larger term called rental housing. Like executive living, student housing, industrial housing, and some of other things which are coming up. And co-living, which I feel is all about community, convenience, and cohabitation. Young professionals continuing to flock to highly populated, high-priced metropolitan areas. The demand for affordable, convenient living options are increasing. And as Anshul was mentioning, it's going to see a large demand in the next 3 to 5 years. I believe that the co-living segment in India may witness higher participation and attract more investment with recent introduction of the Modern Tenancy Act, which we'll cover it in our panel. The introduction of MTA will institutionalize the entire space of co-living segment or the rental housing segment in the country, and will provide a big fillip to private participation in rental housing for addressing the housing shortage in different income groups. So to get in the view of the future of these businesses, we have an extremely distinguished panel on this webinar today. And I'll start with a small introduction. The first one, Dr. Sriram Chituri, who's the CEO of Gesture. He's one of the first co-living companies in India to start this asset class. He's a founding member of NeredCo and founding president of the Rental Housing Association of India. The second person on the panel is Mr. Ritesh Sachdev. Ritesh is Senior Vice President with Tata Realty and Tata Realty and Infrastructure Limited, and he heads the office leasing or leasing segment and asset management for TRIL. Ritesh is a very dynamic and high-performing real estate professional with more than 2 decades of experience, corporate real estate experience with service providers and developers both. As a Senior Vice President for Leasing and Asset Management, Ritesh is responsible to manage the commercial aspect of the Tata Realty from a leasing and managing the assets across the country, besides maximizing the operating performance of the company's commercial portfolio. Ritesh looks at the new innovations and, you know, strategic business development and the profitability of the company as far as the asset class is concerned. And Ritesh has also worked with companies like DLF and also with Cushman & Wakefield in the past. Next. Mr. Arvind Prakash Iyer Swami, he has around 20 years of diverse experience in Fortune multinational companies. And in the most recent last 6 years in real estate, and within that, he is part of the strategy, transaction, projects, FM transport, FNB, EHS, finance, and is currently working with Microsoft India in this particular opportunity. He's also done work in manufacturing and supply chain. He's also done Lean Six Sigma, and he's an expert in ERP, WIP, BOM, SCP, and MRP. Sorry, some of them are a little bit bouncer to me, but he's extremely distinguished panelist here. Next. Pradeep Srinivas, he is currently director with private equity with InvestCorp. And he joined InvestCorp in 2020 from Infinia Kotak Family Office, where he was the head of New Age Investments. And Pradeep has around 16 years plus of experience in investment management and technology. And previously he's worked with Gaja Capital, an Indian focused mid-market private equity firm, and NEA, one of the world's largest venture capital firms. We have on the panel Dr. Nikhil Sikri, and while going through his capabilities, I must say very differentiated approach. And he is an MBBS degree from prestigious College of Ames. And he was a resident doctor in Ames and a psychiatrist at the Indian Institute of Mental Health in Singapore. And then to enhance, he has also done his management degree from ISB Hyderabad. And then he joined Deloitte as a management consultant. And then, the entrepreneurial bug came to him and he started understanding first what will work. And then he realized that a housing segment would really be something he'll be keen for. And he started his own enterprise called Zolo, and where he bringing in a lot of technology play and a lot of operational play to make it a very differentiated product in India. Other panel members, again, very distinguished, Krishna Swami Nakarajan, who is currently the COO of Table Space Technologies. And he's an experienced leader in real estate, workplace strategy, facility management, business consulting, and he's built high technology teams. He's worked in across sectors like IT, BFSI, airline, consulting, and he's also managed global delivery centers. And previous to joining Table Space Technologies, Mr. Krishna Swami Nagarajan was the head of real estate for IBM for Asia Pacific. The other person on the panel is Mr. Rajesh Arora. He's the member finance for Neretco, and he's currently the chairman of TAG Coptim, a real estate conglomerate since 1947. He has over 30 years of experience in the real estate industry, like premium real estate development, boutique firm, real estate advisory, luxury hospitality, and all. And he's advised some of the large multinational companies and personalities in India and abroad in the entire facets of real estate. And he and his company have professional memberships with bodies like EBG, BBG, ISCC, NERETCO, FICCI, IGBC, and he's also a member of Retailer Association of India. Now, you know, having introduced everyone on the panel, we can start some of the questions to ensure that we cover the both co-working as well as co-living or larger set rental housing. I would start with, like I was listening to Dr. Hinandani and some of the points, I would start my panel discussion with a question to Dr. Niranjan Hinandani. Sir, co-working and co-living are the newest asset classes, as you said on the block, over your recent, over your distinguished career. What was your initial reaction to these business models at early stages? And my second part would be, how would you place their utility now post the pandemic with the way market has reacted?
Saurabh, looks like Dr. Hinandani has dropped off. So I think maybe you can go on to the next question.
Sure. So once he comes in, we'll okay. Thanks, Anshul. So my next question, we'll start with a bit flavor on the co-working side. So my first question would be to Krishna. Krishna, the flex space industry or the managed space industry has been recovering very well since end of last year. And we see that momentum in growth continuing this year as well, and we expect that moving forward as well. What is driving this growth despite some bit of uncertainty faced by the broader office market globally as well as in India, as what Anshul was also mentioning? You are muted, Krishna.
Saurabh, thanks. Great question. Before I start, a word of thanks to Dr. Hinandani and Anshul. Great insights and very well summed up on what's happening. And Anshul, thanks for bringing in the regional and international flavor around it. I think I will start off by saying, Saurabh, is that traditional real estate space has always been rigid and straitjacketed. And while the business has evolved dramatically over the years, the office space has been there or thereabouts where it was, because offices were built 10 years back, 15 years back. That was when the real boom happened. And the space didn't evolve accordingly. We do changes in bits and pieces. I've been part of the corporate life before this, and what we all experienced, business is exponentially changing. On the last 2 years, the COVID time has completely changed on its head the way business is being done. The dynamic nature of business delivery, the way people want to operate, the expectation of employees, the expectation of organizations, for real estate to keep pace is exactly where the managed space came into play. This is run by a bunch of professionals whose core competency is running and delivering quality real estate operational space. And I think that's become a big fill up. And also, from to borrow a phrase from Dr. Hinandani, businesses are focusing on the business of their business. That means they want more focus on how to sustain and develop the core of that business in these dynamic and enterprising times. And that's where they are looking at experts or subject matter experts or delivery experts to take care of this end-to-end solution. And I think what we are seeing is, for example, a corporate office, a traditional office will take time to plan, initiate, execute, deliver, and then operationalize. It's a 24-month life cycle, quite literally, from the time concept is initiated. By the time the entire need of the business, what it was a year and a half back, has completely changed. Earlier, the transformation used to happen over a bunch of five years. Today, the transformation is every month. Every month you come back, the worlds are changing. Earlier, when the COVID started, it was called the new normal. Then they called it the new abnormal. Then it's business as usual, right? So I think that is where this is a big piece where and I would continue to call it the managed space, and I would continue to call it the integrated workplace areas. And that's where the key component is started to come in, and businesses are realizing the importance and the value that this model can deliver. So I think that's one of the key drivers on where we see this exponential, request for demand for this space, sort of.
Thank you. Thanks, Krishna. I clearly agree with what you have said, and I'll try to use more of managed space and integrated workspace rather than saying co-working.
That's also an evolution.
sure. So continuing with that, you know, as Krishna, you rightly said, what the occupier is thinking, and you know, in your previous experience within IBM, as well as, you know, we have someone from Microsoft, you know, Arvind, who's there, and thank you, Arvind, for joining on the panel today. My question to Arvind too would be, you know, having you know, currently working with Microsoft, is, you know, the real we feel that the real success story of, you know, managed space, co-working, flex space happened because of the confidence from enterprises, like large enterprises, and one of them is like Microsoft. So what made these large enterprises made to take this bait of the co-working space, and some of the top criterion when someone like a large enterprise or any enterprise look at selecting or finalizing a space of the managed workspace?
I think Krishna took some of my thunder out, but you know, from an occupier perspective, you know, the flex spaces actually provide us build some flexibility into our otherwise rigid portfolio. You know, owned or traditionally spaces, we consider the flex spaces to offer a lot more flexibility, either addition or reduction. The other point that Krishna mentioned is also, you know, from an agility standpoint, you know, the world is changing. Change is the only constant that we've been taught now, right? This is the only model that actually can provide us to support any unforecasted growth over any traditional solution. That's a key driver, actually. That's the reason we've been taking flex spaces over the last 3 to 4 years. And if I were to quickly summarize, you know, the drivers, I would put it in three words. You know, it's leaner, meaner, and faster. When I say leaner, it primarily is a hands-off model. You know, as long as you know, as Microsoft, we give out our design guidelines, you know, to any of the co-working operators, you know, they take care of pretty much the transactions, the projects, the design piece, the projects, and running the whole show, right? And as long as we define like the SLAs and preferred location, I think everything else is taken care of. I say meaner because less capital intensive. Anshul did address some bit of it, but in this unforeseen circumstances, it's easier to ask for limited capex, which we only use it for spending on our IT, AV, and security gear. And the last bit is obviously the fastness in which the solution can be done. You know, we're talking of 6 months. You know, with a couple of operators recently, we've been able to deliver space in about 6 months of identifying the need, which in a traditional build will take us 15 to 18 months. So those are really the key considerations for us, right? In terms of from when we are looking at, I think the last question was from you, from an operator perspective, what do we look for, right? Obviously, you know, all of them are startups in our books, right? So we look for some sort of financial stability as we want to look for, obviously, the continuation. Second would be, you know, the credibility and clientele, right? In terms of giving us the comfort feel that they will be able to run the show. And third thing is obviously we no longer call them suppliers or vendors. We actually look at partnership, right? There are changes, like Krishna said, yeah, changes come every month. For us, it comes in every week. So, you know, the agility to accommodate any changes that we would need. And obviously, no compromise on a user experience. You know, we put a lot of emphasis on employee experience. So even if we move our employees between an own solution to a traditional lease to a you know, exclusive co-working or an enterprise model, we obviously don't want employees to see a difference. I think those are some of the key considerations that we look for.
Thank you, Arvind. I think very well summarized, and you know, I think this will go a long way in everyone understanding, also, you know, the people who are listening to all of us. You know, my next question, continuing within the co-working segment, you know, my next question would be to Ritesh, who's, you know, has obviously an experience of service provider, as well as now being very integrated working with Tata Realty as a developer, and they have dovetailed into a large office player, or I would say commercial real estate player. So my question to Ritesh would be, you know, Ritesh, do you think there will be a coexisting within the developer community? And you know, due to the nature of business that occupiers have, earlier there were barriers due to security, data, etc. So how are the developers addressing this in going to be the, you know, in the future ahead, and what even Arvind mentioned, how they would like their operator to be or the developer to be?
So thank you. And before I start, just a quick word of thanks to Anshul, to Dr. Hiranandani, and to all of the very eminent panelists for sharing their views. I'm conscious of time, and what I would like to do is just, in a way, try and summarize everything, and then we can, you know, take those questions and answer anything in greater detail as may be required. I think the first step for any, when newer businesses are coming up, is denial. But we've seen over the last, I'd say, 5 or 7 years on the rise and rise of enterprise solution providers, you know, co-working companies, managed offices, or whatever that you may. My sense, both will need to coexist, and both will coexist. If there was ever a, if there was ever a defining moment, I'd say it has been COVID. There have been a lot of positive, and of course, a lot of grief that people have gone through. If I were to just, you know, 3 or 4 things overall, what upgrade? CRE in India would be strategic. We had times where you had additional capacity. Between Arvind and Krishna, they'd be able to appreciate this. So any decisions today will need to be strategic in nature. Clearly, safety is of paramount importance. We've been deferring back to offices now by every quarter, and you know, safety is of paramount importance, and I think so is well-being. A lot of, I'd say, partners and IPCs today, when building shortlisting criteria happens, well-being and safety is amongst the preeminent factors that need to be a part of any project or a building shortlist. The third is sustainability, and you'd see from you know, the developer community, any and every business will need to be sustainable. And I think during a building partner shortlist, sustainability and the contribution that organizations will need to make will have a broader criteria. Finally, as we are saying, change is the only constant. As a matter of fact, before this panel, I was speaking to I'd say aggregator of all services that may be required, from food to the additional capacity, not just in offices. And across, it has to be smart. Buildings will need to be smarter today. Solutions will need to be smarter today. So the developer community needs to upgrade and work around that. I'd spoken about the increase in the number of, in my sense, Saurabh, before I was to hand it back to you, I think it will evolve. As I said, COVID is a defining moment, but I'm also conscious of the fact of the role that tier two, tier three cities play. The very social nature of the employees, does migration to a tier one, you know, will that come back? Do organizations, employers need to manage and maintain their identity? Is this something which is temporary? All is fluid, given, you know, the ever-changing situation of COVID, and I think it will take a while for those things to stabilize. Saurabh, back to you.
Thanks, Ritesh. I think very pertinent points, and some of the points which really need to be looked at as we move forward, and as rightly summed up, you know. So my next question, pivoting to a little bit more on the co-living and rental housing side. My first question to Dr. Nikhil Sikri would be, you know, the two lockdowns, one in last year and one this year, have made a lot of people move back to their hometowns, what we have seen. And that must have created a vacancy. How was the business affected then? And what measures did you as an organization or the larger rental housing community take to keep business going in these lockdown times, whenever happened, and we expect third wave or fourth wave to come in. So there's some view of yours, Dr. Nikhil, on that.
Sure. So at Zolo, we have a couple of core principles or values which we believe in. And I would say during lockdown, the three values really came into play. One is obsessive focus on the customer. Second is building deep relationships. And third is continuous evolution. So in our focus on the customer, we launched a lot of initiatives for them. We were perhaps very much, before even government sort of instated strong lockdowns, we were already following WHO protocols, looking at the international patterns and all. We started giving free health insurance to every one of Zoloite, because not all of them were covered through their policies, and especially COVID was not covered in their policies. So we got a COVID covering policy for every single Zoloite. We ensured that the food is delivered in hot boxes instead of sort of as congregate level, because we didn't want any crowding. So that was more on the customer side, that how did we manage the customers who were with us, and because occupancy obviously was decent occupancy, it didn't go to zero. Then second, as I said, deep relationships. So our relationships with our asset partners have been always very strong and deep. And that allowed us to protect our P&L for the most part, where we both shared the hit that it comes from the vacancy. And I would say that we were really lucky and blessed to have great asset partners. And the third piece is continuous evolution. On that note, we accelerated our vision of managed living. So when we talk at Zolo, we talk about managed living as a construct. So for us, managed living has four pillars: student housing, co-living, multifamily houses, and senior homes. So these are the four pillars of managed living for us. So we've accelerated our vision aggressively on that side. We've built a very, very large and student presence now, which was 10% of our portfolio last year. Now we'll be around 45% of our portfolio as colleges open. We've been able to bring in a lot of new technology and new signed up growth for co-living. So although we haven't made the assets live, because it doesn't make sense to make them live right now, but we've worked on signing up a lot of assets on the co-living side. On the multifamily side, we've started working with a couple of other partners to work in the residential space as well. So this and this overlaid by, we got good amount of time to focus a lot more on technology. So we've brought in tenant matching algorithms. So this is a very common problem, like people don't like each other when they are paired. So we brought in tenant matching algorithms. As I said, hot boxes, individual delivery of food. So you can choose which meal do you want, North Indian, South Indian, when do you want, morning, evening, do you want weekends? So that accelerated our vision. And macro, which was very negative from the vacancy standpoint, but helped us really in terms of our expansion plans, because it cleared out the deck. So co-living is in a structure of a macro structure is very fundamentally different from co-working. Co-working came as a structured environment as a replacement of office spaces which were being rented or owned or bought. Co-living was always there in a very unorganized fashion, large number. The lowest estimate that we have of co-living beds, all top four players combined, we still don't make more than 2%. So for us, the market which creates pain, and if you can survive through that, for us, the 2% guys, it leaves a lot of room to expand aggressively going forward. Because before pandemic, there was aggressive competition from these unorganized guys, because they play on a different rule set, which is they don't pay taxes. So it's not like they're uncompetitive. They might be unorganized, but they're not uncompetitive. So COVID has cleared out the deck from a very large space and left an open playground for all of us to capture, and which we are capitalizing on. As I said, we have signed up large amounts of inventory for future. We've aggressively increased our student housing portfolio. And technology obviously allows us to give a much better offering. So the two lockdowns, obviously we were hit in the short run in terms of vacancies, but it really, really helped us to accelerate our long-term play, building a brand with the customers in terms of a brand which really takes care of them, knowing that our relationships are actually deep, they're not just on paper, and then getting that comfort that people do come and support when it's needed, and accelerating the vision of managed living on from co-living to other verticals as well, and fundamentally getting a competitive edge, which is a deck which got cleared out, which allows us to aggressively expand. Although co-living as a market, I'm quite sure will take a percentage hit as a market. So the 100 will become 90, but the two people, the top four players, the top five players, the 2% still has 88% more to go. So there will be a little bit of shrinkage in co-living market because of how the flexible work from home, remote, permanent remote work from home is becoming a viable option for a small percentage of people. I'm not saying it's a very large number. For that small percentage of people, that 5 to 8 to 10% people where this will become a viable option, so that will shrink the market or the industry by around 10%, at least for 1 year, and then it will recover back as the growth comes back. So one and a half year, we can expect a shrinkage of 10%. But for players like us, the organized players, it's actually a blessing in disguise in some sense that we can make our 2 to 10 or 15, and we have 88% quite cleared out now.
Sure. Thank you, Dr. Nikhil. Really good to see you are a good numbers man, and I can see everything is very well engraved, and how you have used the current condition to the advantage of this industry of rental housing, and I'm sure it is that. My next question dovetailing on that would be from Mr. Sriram Chaturi, who is one of the co-founding members in the Redco as well as one of the first ones to start co-living as a concept. So my question to you would be, Sriram, what are the, government regulations which you see, or the ones which you would like, you all would like to see post-COVID from the perspective of Model Tenancy Act, which has come in at a very early stage, but what's your thoughts on that?
Thank you, Saurabh. See, Model Tenancy Act is essentially a acknowledgement of the Government of India for the fact that rental housing is going to be one of the key instruments in delivering housing for all objects of the nation. Essentially, with the young population today, where we are at mean age around 26, 28, and with 65% of the population being under the age of 35, and the millennial numbers are always talking about 440 million. So all these people need to be housed. And essentially, that's where this whole broad rental housing category is coming into play. And it's being called by various things. Some people call it paying guests, some people call it hostels, some people call it student housing, some people call it rental housing, whatever it is, a broad rental housing category, as like you said earlier. So essentially, these megatrends which are at play currently, like migration, changing demographics, increased women workforce, unorganized to organized, all these are what are being sort of captured in this whole co-living play which is being played out currently. And as far as the government is concerned, government in October 2015 brought in something called National Urban Rental Housing Policy. But unfortunately, that got stalled there. And thanks to COVID, again, we're seeing a renewed interest from the government in recognizing the importance of rental housing for the nation's growth. And that's how they brought in Model Tenancy Act. They brought in something called Affordable Rental Housing Complexes Policy for enabling creation of rental housing stock, and also for management of rental housing stock, but more from the LIG and EDR segment. But ultimately, that's going to eventually come out for the entire population. So one more thing which we are eagerly looking forward is for the National Urban Rental Housing Policy, which draft is already out in circulation, which will sort of pave way for formalization of this entire space. Currently, the standards are not there. Unorganized players have a different level playing field, where they, not only from a perspective of not paying taxes, they don't follow the basic minimum rules from a national building code perspective, giving the adequate number of square feet per person requires to have a decent living, density of toilets, et cetera, et cetera. So all those things will get regulated sooner or later once these things come into play, the competition comes into play. And that will help this whole industry change from this whole unorganized segment to an organized segment. So COVID has been a very significant factor in enabling that change. So yes, COVID temporarily has impacted all of us, but ultimately COVID is the one thing which is not going to benefit all of us in the future because of the long-term changes which is needed. And government's push from regulating this whole space is going to turn the organization to organize industry.
Thank you, Mr. Sinam. I think this interplay of government's keen focus on this particular, tenancy segment, and with, strong players like all of you and some of you on the panel today, would really help this segment moving forward. And as Dr. Nikhil said, you are still capturing only 2% of the market. So that's a great to know. My next question to all of this is good, but all of this needs money, right? Eventually. And, it's a support of the institution on any of these segments, be it co-working or co-living or rental housing. Institutions having confidence on these sectors would be very key moving forward. So my question to Pradeep would be, last few years, we have seen, substantial private equity VC investments in both of these segments of rental housing and managed space or flex space, but they have gone largely to large operators or very few operators. As we move forward, what are the key metrics that investors like you or the larger community of investors, Indian and global in nature, looking to make their investment decisions on especially on these asset classes of rental housing as well as co-working and everything?
Yeah, that's a great question, Saurabh. Firstly, let me take a minute to acknowledge all the eminent speakers here and their diverse views, which have kind of enriched our collective understanding of this space. Thank you all. You mentioned about how investments in this space have been focused on few operators. You also mentioned the term large operators, and there's a reason for that. The business of flex spaces, as you call it, and I'm glad you call it flex spaces, because the common misconception for a lot of people around co-working, for example, is that it's a business that caters only to startups and freelancers, while they form a very important constituent of the customer group. The large customers are still enterprises, right? So the reason why we're talking about capital going after specific players is because this is a vision business. This is a business where you can't think local, where one size doesn't fit all. And the needs of one company or one individual is very different from the other. You cannot take a cookie cutter approach to this business, right? And for you to be able to embark on this business, you'll need to kind of invest ahead of time. And when you have to invest ahead of time, you need to have the maturity to plan, both your execution as well as your capital commitment, because it has to come together for you to be able to fulfill the promise that you're making to your customers. So as investors, we like to see evidence of that promise. We want to see if you've thought through where you want to be present. We want to see if you've helped your customers scale effectively from maybe a 10-member organization to a 500-member organization. We want to see if you've helped your customers, be it enterprises or individuals, move from one city to another within your network. We want to see if you offer enterprises and individuals the diverse functionality that they may need. This could be as simple as a shared pantry to offering very complicated data security and things like that. Right? And most importantly, we want to see your ability to do all of this in a capital efficient way and a profitable way, because it kind of goes hand in hand. So as investors, we are looking at your ability to kind of execute very closely across these parameters and make good your promise to your customers as one of the key deciding criteria when we kind of look at teams which want to kind of do this. In the interest of time, I'd like to hand it back to you, but happy to take any questions on this.
Surely. I think your points were very pertinent and it's very important for everyone to understand.
Sorry, Pradeep. I think your points were very pertinent, and I think it goes a long way to for every operator or the owners to understand how to attract the capital, because that's a very important play as we move forward. My next question, again, back to co-working. You know, we have around 10 minutes before we open for Q&A. So my quick question and a quick answer I would request from Krishna is, you know, we are seeing some large flex spaces operators pivoting towards a predominantly managed space model to cater to growing enterprise demand. In what other ways could business model evolve as operator pursue faster growth going forward beyond the enterprise?
Saurabh, it's a very, very valid thing. And from a table space perspective, table space has been the pioneer in managed workspace solutions. And to Dr. Pradeep's point, you know, it's no more called co-working because the whole focus is on addressing the enterprise segment of the business. And you know what? How the acceleration is happening is because of we are employing machine learning, deploying tech. The management teams that you see of the, you know, especially I can talk of Tailspace for sure. The type of people whom you want to be managing it is the people who know how to solution the larger problem. It is not about just about selling a product that you have. It is about curating a product that the customer wants now, because it's about scale. And again, you know, what we do typically is make sure that when a stakeholder or when a customer or when a client is with you, you would be wanting to give them a solution. Flexibility is no more about lock-ins. Flexibility is about telling them, if you are growing from one city to another, we'll be able to give you that growth. If you're scaling up, scaling down, the model and the technology allows you to do that. And by involving tech, we increase productivity in terms of right from parking solutions to lift solutions to cafeteria occupancy solutions, helping our customers and walking the journey along with them to tell them what is going to be more effective, how we can help them focus on it in a more effective way. Because what's more important is the model to be scalable, sustainable, and repeatable. A corporate traditional model is sustainable, but from a scalable and repeatable model, we are ensuring that the tech parts are, you know, plays a big part. And you know, this is going to be one of the key components that sort of ensures that we evolve as well. We don't want to be stagnant. The very reason this model is successful, because traditional real estate was a very stable and stagnant model. So this is where the flexibility is going to come in, and tech is going to play a big part. And the management team that you have on board has to know what the client wants, even before the client tells you what they want. I think that's the relationship that's going to be happening. And we heard Arvind sometime back calling everybody partners, and it's a partnership from here on. And the partnership is, what do you really want? I'll be able to do a fast turnaround, basically, you know, with the type of people and with the type of technology that we deploy. So I'll keep it very short and back to you for the next panel.
Thanks, Krishna. And you know, very, very, very understandable what you have said. Continuing, as you said, tech would be a major play. And during my past interactions also with Dr. Nikhil, my question to Nikhil would be, you know, how is technology being leveraged by leading co-living or rental housing operators to make the living spaces suitable for young professionals? And, you know, how is it making changing their design protocols, accommodation offerings, keeping in mind stringent requirement of health safety standards, and then last but most important, to attract global capital?
Fair and great question. I'm sure a lot of people would be interested in knowing where is the tech here. So you can look at tech from two perspectives. One is the front-end tech and one is the back-end tech. So front-end tech is about how do you serve the customer better, and back-end tech is about eventually serving the customer better, but it's primarily targeted at managing your services and operations in a more efficacious and more productive way. So the front-end tech, as I mentioned, if you subscribe to Zolo and other good co-living players, not to say just only Zolo, you'll be able to customize your living quite well. You can choose your space requirement. Do you require 30 square feet, 16, the entire room to yourself? Do you require food? Do you not require food? Do you require participate in the community events? Do not participate in the community events? Engage with people. So that's on the side of building a great flexible and community-led offering. Fundamentally, that's what co-living is, and affordability is the foundation on which all of this is laid on. So that flexibility and community is driven more by the front-end customer-facing tech. And then there is a back-end tech, which basically ensures that all of this works. Like if customer has subscribed for food, food needs to reach there. For that to reach, there are 40 steps that happen. There is an order which gets placed with the vendor or your in-house kitchen, and the kitchen needs a certain grocery in that regard, and then certain order needs to be, your entire supply chain needs to be managed from there on. Then it needs to be, logistics needs to be managed, that it needs to reach the right person at right time, at right place, in the right fashion, in the right, let's say, a heat mount. Then when you say community, I mean, it's easy to say let's build community, but community itself requires 40 steps before someone will come and engage with you. So so that is the play which technology sort of provides you from the back-end perspective to fulfill those promises. And the next piece, of evolution on the back-end, once you fulfill those perspectives, is the cost advantage. Because as you start doing at scale and you leverage technology well, your costs will be lower than somebody who is not at scale. Then it becomes a virtuous cycle in some sense, that you can continuously keep leveraging your edge of being large to become more large. And that's what, I mean, we've seen across all technology businesses. That's not just true for any co-living business per se, that you can see for all technology business that larger becomes even larger because they tend to get an unfair edge because of their ability to provide the tech offerings, as well as the ability to manage cost at a level that other people can't do in, at that point. So, I mean, I can go on and on. I can spend like 2-3 hours here, but in the interest of time, I'll just stop and just recap the quick framework on the front end customer facing side and back end side. Back end is fulfilling promises and optimizing on your cost and monitoring the efficacy of your efforts, because a lot of times in a startup, you are going so fast in a hustle DNA that a job which can be done in like by two people is being done by five, and technology sort of helps you recognize and acknowledge that fact and helps you correct that as you want.
Sure. I think we'll have...
I'm sorry to interrupt you. I believe Mr. Rajesh Shura has raised his
hand. Yes. I was going to that.
Thank you.
Yeah, Rajesh Ji, you raised your hand. Anything from your end? Thank you.
just wanted to, get involved the role of the three major agencies, that is the government, the operators, and the developers. You know, how these three agencies can, coordinate with each other for the promotion of co-working and co-living. So I'd like to comment on that, if you permit.
Sure, sir. Rajeshji.
Market has transformed so much since 2015, what has been said, with the all eminent players, that, we cannot ignore the concepts of co-working and the co-living. And all the property, most of the property, whether it is Mumbai or whether it is Delhi, particularly, most of these old properties are very, very undervalued. So all these, can be repurposed for co-living and co-working. When I say, even if you go to Barakhamba Road, or, you go to KG Marg, or you go to Karol Bagh, or you go to Fort in Mumbai, most of these buildings are they're unusable. So they can be worked with the government, with the developers, with the operators, whether of co-working or co-living, to repurpose. But for that, we have to create a win-win situation. A co-working or a co-living player cannot push the owners of the old buildings, look, we will invest, you will get a very nominal rentals for that. So there has to be, a win-win situation. Then, from the government, although with the Model Tenancy Act has helped so much, because what happened, like we as the Aurora Group, we're in this industry for the last 77 years. About 70% of the houses are vacant and they are not leased with the fear that it will never get, they will not get the rent and they'll not get vacation. Now with the Model Tenancy Act, these things, it will bring a lot of transparency in the entire system. Then, you know, there's another thing which I would like to appeal to the government, that they should allow a one-bedroom dwelling unit, because normally three-bedroom dwelling unit or a four-bedroom dwelling units are allowed in a smaller plots. So with a co-living, you know, one-bedroom suite with attached bath and kitchen is good enough. So we have to work, NAREDCO can work with the government, whether it is MCG of Gurgaon or DDA of Delhi or Bombay Municipal Corporation, to allow approvals of the dwelling units to be approved as one bedroom instead of three bedroom or a four bedroom. So that would also promote, you know, a usability of space in the old buildings. And at the end, you know, I would like to ask two things. So whenever the house is open for questions, I have two things to ask. So whenever it is open, you can allow me that.
Sure, sure, Rajeshji. Great.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So, Sumit, shall we take few questions which are on the Q&A now? I have few more questions, but keeping in mind, we have another 10, 12 minutes.
If everybody allows, we can extend it by maybe like in 10, 15 minutes, if everybody is okay with the, if all the panelists are okay with the idea. Because we have like almost like 10 to 12 questions right now, which is there in the chat box. And plus, I believe, and few of you also wanted to ask each other in some of the questions. So it's totally up to you if you can extend it by 10, 15 minutes, please. I believe everybody has said, go ahead. I'm not sure if the panelist or the
No. Silence is golden. So, you know, it's good that we move ahead. I think everyone is quite engaged. So before we get into the question, I have one question from Arvind as well, you know, coming from the occupied side. You know, Arvind, with the employees moving towards smaller towns or hometowns, would occupiers be keen to look at setting up, you know, smaller spaces in these tier two, tier three, tier four cities, thereby capturing businesses in these locations? And obviously, once the occupier moves in, you will have, you know, the co-working players, the co-living players, the rental housing players, all of them would come in. What do you think about a strategy as a large scale occupiers moving ahead in the next 3 to 5 years?
Look, the hybrid workplace, you know, that's a new buzzword, you know, and it is still a very big unknown, right? Puts us in a lot of dilemma, but unfortunately, we don't have an yes or a no answer, and what could be a correct answer as well. Nobody has a crystal ball. Everybody seems to be scrambling to a solution around it. But it is great, you know, in the sense of being in this dilemma, at least, you know, there are, in the last 15, 16 months, people have been able to work from anywhere, employees, right? There's great infrastructure, be it the cloud, be it collab platforms like Teams, and data connectivity, right? Making it affordable as well as reliable as well, you know? And government policy relaxations, you know, earlier the DOT and TRAI used to have restrictions on BPOs and KPO, data, voice traffic. I think government has also woken up to that occasion, right? And made it now being allowing employees to work from anywhere practically. Addressing your specific question, you know, one data point that stood out in the pandemic is that, you know, we were trying to take stock of where our employees were, and roughly 50% of our talent work, you know, our employees have moved back to their hometowns, right? Outside of our talent hubs. Now it's an opportunity to rethink our entire strategy, right? And puts in the dilemma, you know, does it make sense? Is this the new normal, right? Does it make sense to approve these employees from their ecosystem and bring them into already overcrowded, overstressed cities, right? Or would they be better off allowing them to operate from their hometowns? It also helps building the local economy, right? And, you know, improve their local ecosystem, you know, the great example is Zoho. I don't know if you're following Zoho from, you know, they're primarily based in villages now, right? And they are providing the CRM platform, and it works perfectly fine. But the challenge would be, you know, how do we inculcate our culture and values and collaboration? How do we make someone coming in from a remote village as productive as somebody is working out of a Redmond office, right? I think that's probably the biggest challenge that we're looking at. We're going to wait and watch approach, if I remember, your last question was for the operators, right? Some of these cities don't even have established IFM players, IPCs. So my gut feel is, I think there is a great potential out there. Things should start crystallizing over the next 6 months to 1 year. But I think there is a lot of potential this pandemic has actually will open its doors to both operators as well as everybody out there in this field.
Thank you, Arvind. Thank you. That's insightful. So we have, like Sumit said, we have 12, 13 questions. Obviously, we'll take one or two of them on the call today. And before taking that up, I was thinking of a case, Rajeshji, I have one question for you. And, what I was thinking of, what you're also talking about, an interplay and repurposing the place with government, developer and operator. And there is definitely an interplay between, real estate regulations and the operators. Is there some thought what you have, how they can work more cohesively to help the process, the sector, and bring more transparency?
Yes. Good morning again. This is Rajesh Arora, and I thank you for including me in the panel. Yet definitely, like I said, that there's going to be a very cohesive play between the three, the government, the operators, and the developers. So the government has helped and taken the initiative by having the Model Tenancy Act. Because from times immemorial, near the university for co-living, we had Kamla Nagar and all those areas where there were old houses and poor college university students used to live in those conditions, having bad bathrooms. Is my voice audible?
You're audible. Yes, you're audible, please.
Okay. So with the Model Tenancy Act, new residential building will come up. And also, the government can give approvals for more FAR near to the university's areas. Like we have, in let's say from Delhi point of view, we have a university area near Civil Lines, and we have university area near, Atmaram. And wherever we have large universities, they should allow residential to be high rise so that it can promote student accommodation. So there where the government can help. And like I said before, all these old buildings, whether residential or commercial, they can be realigned. All these can be repurposed, and with the investments putting by developers and these co-working and the co-living players, they can also help the developers to invest, and they can do some minimum rentals and a revenue sharing. So there has to be a win-win situation for the owners and the operators, whether co-living or co-working.
Thank you, Rajeshji. That's insightful. My first question, which has been asked by Deepak Sharma, and I would request Ritesh to take up that question, and if anyone else within the panel would like to add. Deepak Sharma says, thank you all for this insightful discussion. What is your suggestion to a landowner?
Saurabh, what is your suggestion to a landowner? Can you explain a bit more on that question, please?
So this is a direct question. He just says, thank you all for this insightful discussion. So I presume what he's saying, if I'm just a landowner, I'm not a developer, I'm not someone who can build, but I am a landowner. What is the suggestion of the panel with operators and with developers like you and Dr. Hiranandani and everyone on the panel today, and the operators and the investor like Pradeep on the call today? As I said, his simple question is, what is your suggestion to a landowner moving forward on these asset classes? I think that's what my presumption is.
My sense, Saurabh, is you're the best person to answer this question. You know, from a land perspective, highest and best use needs to be done to be able to ascertain asset classes that perhaps will be profitable in the near future. From a developer's perspective, from Tata Realty's perspective, we're clear that we will quadruple building world-class office spaces. We see offshoots of demand coming back from a co-working perspective. I mean, dare I say co-working, enterprise solutions, managed offices, whatever that it may be. We've now seen that there is more demand today, or most demand today, for enterprise solutions. And therefore, picking up, I'd say, offices or any of the other areas, till the time that you've got back-to-back demand has gone down substantially, because there is a lot of supply that needs to be filled up. So enterprise-led demand is the order of the day. And as I'd mentioned earlier, both will coexist. But as I said, from a developer's perspective, from Tata Realty's perspective, we're bullish on segregation on grade A offices vis-a-vis all of the others, because most CREs, most organizations today would reevaluate their strategy and focus on world-class, safer, sustainable, smart offices. Saurabh?
Thank you. Thanks. I was very tempted to answer that. However, I thought you, having worn this hat of mine in the past and now being a developer, that's what I was thinking. So thanks. Oh, thanks, Ritesh.
I'll add another 1 minute to that.
Please, please.
So, I mean, it depends on also the size of land that you own. From a resi perspective, I can speak, not from the office side. If the size is up to 2 acres, co-living makes a lot of sense, because in co-living perspective, that 2 acres is a decent size to start. And in fact, we have a capital markets team which work with landowners to transform these assets or these less small land parcels into co-living spaces. So it depends on the size. If you have large, you can go for, you can look at tying up with a developer for a large resi society. But if you have small land parcels which are near the office spaces, co-living or student housing, either way, if it's near universities, it's student housing. If it's near college, office spaces, it's co-living. Makes a lot of sense. And in fact, senior homes can also be looked at, if not in 2 acres, but slightly larger parcels. So it sort of depends on the size of land as well.
Sorry, you're muted.
Yeah, sorry. Thanks, thanks, Nikhil. Actually, one question again on the co-living side. Someone, Kevin Russell, has written from US, and he's writing, and I would request everyone from the co-living, even Pradeep, also to look at the question. As a current developer of co-living environments in the USA, I'm challenged by the competing personalities and idiosyncrasies of various tenants. Some of them do not get along. Does anyone know of a key component software app helping to match co-living tenants? I believe a personality test would help analyze various types of people.
I mean, we have an algorithm, but we've still not started selling it as an independent software. but it relies on personality assessments, and it matches personality scores with people. And there are weightages of different scores basis. Because you have to understand your customer, there are weightages of different scores basis the friction that it causes. For example, you don't want a smoker to get mixed with a non-smoker, so that's like a no-no. So you segregate them clearly. So there are weightages of different habits and different personality types. And then you conclude, so I'm just giving a very high level summary of how can one go about building algorithm around it.
Sure. Another question I have, is it's an open question and request if anyone wants to take it. How is consolidation, reorganization panning out in the co-working sector? And again, how is consolidation happening in the co-living segment?
So maybe I can take this up. Sorry, Ritesh.
No, Pradeep, I was suggesting either you or Krishna. Please go for it.
Sure, thank you. So I probably speak about this from a co-living point of view. While there are a lot of consolidation opportunities in co-living, and we're seeing some consolidation happen as well, I think the crux to creating a great co-living company is execution. Without which it is very difficult to deliver an ROI. And the reason for this is very simple, right? If you look at the way unit economics are stacked in co-living, you know, we're talking about a bed that generates 10, 12,000 rupees of revenue a month, as opposed to, let's say, low-end hospitality, where you're talking about 3,000-5,000 rupees a bed a night, right? So you're actually playing with a small revenue number in some sense, and you have to optimize all the costs that come below on the execution side, on the operating side. And more importantly, you have to optimize on all the other spends that you have to do, which is both on the acquisition side, as well as on the fit out or development side, right? And in some sense, this is a skill that comes out of having done this over and over again. And certain companies do it much better than the others. So when I look at consolidation here, you know, having access to properties, for example, may not necessarily cut it. Where consolidation may actually help is perhaps having access to revenue streams that help companies diversify. So from a co-living point of view, again, we've seen a lot of co-living players are focused largely on B2C IT demand, but there is demand from other sectors, other services. There's also demand to be had from B2B, like Nikhil rightly said, you know, Zolo is focusing on student housing and industrial housing, and perhaps consolidation from people who've kind of delved into that space and have a critical mass could be more interesting than just offering more of what an established player already has. So that's how I kind of look at consolidation from a co-living point of view.
Sure, Pradeep. Thanks. Krishna, you want to add anything on that?
I wouldn't want to comment on consolidation right now. It's because the market is not consolidating, as in consolidating, it's expanding at this point of time.
Sure.
The larger players are coming up with more technology to ensure that there is quality delivery in terms of what a client wants anymore. It's not about aggregation. It's not about trying to, you know, bunch things together. The competition will crystallize and clear itself out in terms of who delivers quality and who delivers a solution versus who delivers a product. So I think it's an evolving phase right now. It's way too early to comment on consolidation because the numbers are quite a large in both segments and quite a large of the names are unknown. So there are standalone operators, there are one city operators. So from a larger perspective, I think the Pan India presence players will have a greater play in this. And the players who have a more corporate focus, a more enterprise focus, and a more solution-based focus are the ones that are going to deliver greater value for this model to succeed as a whole. I would rather work, you know, concentrate on the model as such, rather than trying to look at who, where, and when, because this is not a game of competition. You are actually competing with yourself. At least at a company like Tablespace, we are very, very clear and focused on where we want to be, which are the clients we want to deal with, what's our next level of growth, and how do we want to solution this overall. So, you know, opportunity that's there in the market. So I would rather have an answer in these lines, you know, if that works for you, Saurabh.
Yeah, I think that's very well placed. And I personally also think in the similar direction, Krishna, that let the time weigh out, but some of the factors which will entail who would stay in this business is very important, like you mentioned. Just continuing on that, there's another question and it's for managed space, but I would also add, if anyone from the you know, the co-living side or rental housing would like to add also, is there a difference in terms of tier one and tier two cities, tier two, tier three cities, tier one, tier two, and tier three cities requirement of managed space, and I would add rental housing in India, and which group of cities will see better growth among those smaller cities? So Krishna, Ritesh, Dr. Nikhil, you know, and Sriram, Pradeep, anyone? It's an open question. We just wanted to.
I'll just give a first heads up on the managed space segment in tier two, tier three.
Sure.
an evolving phase. Currently, the establishing is happening in the major cities, first things first. And tier two, the requirements will very, very clearly be different. It won't be the same as a grade A or a tier one location or the major cities. Also, it's going to depend on the kind of clients who are going to move in there. A larger client, a client who is trying to focus expansion into tier two cities as a business model, might be okay, because the cost of construction and certain things don't change very, very dramatically. It's about expanding the base for the corporates. So I think it's going to be more driven by what a corporation wants, with whom these developments are going to happen, rather than set up shop for a tier two location at this point of time. That's the next stage of evolution. Tier two, tier three can't be ignored. That's where the real growth will happen at some point of time. But the growth will follow the enterprises and the corporations and the big organizations on how they plan to stretch their workforce presence into those cities. So that's what's going to drive it majorly. And yes, there will be a very, very clear distinction of the kind of product that will be on offer. It will not only be based on the tier two, tier three cities capabilities, but more also aligned to the type of corporations who go and set up base there.
From a co-living perspective, it's a function of three things: migration, employment opportunities, and education opportunities. So wherever these things are available, I think that's where the demand will be there. So nothing distinguishes from a tier one, tier two, tier three city from an infrastructure perspective, because broadly it's the house, shelter, whatever is a basic necessity for anybody, any person, any human being as such. So it doesn't make a difference as such. So ultimately, where the volumes are more, the cost of operations can be optimized, and the service delivery cost will be much lower compared to where the volumes are less. And it'll be eventually what I believe is going to become a localized play, where you need, I agree with Pradeep G, where he says that it's a highly, technology definitely has its own role to play, but it's very, very execution intensive, and you need to have economies of scale to deliver the services promised. So essentially the quantum of people whom you can sort of service in a particular micro market, a particular location is really going to be defining, and that's going to lead to a lot of local players, just like how you see in real estate industry. We'll have a lot of local players also, we'll have pan-India players also, we'll have regional players also, as we have city players also.
Sure. Anyone would like to add anything on this question?
I'd like to quickly add one perspective from a medium-term point of view. If you look at co-living, co-living today is largely split between housing for professionals and housing for students. I think housing for professionals will largely focus on tier one cities, because that's where the jobs are, that's where large businesses are, at least in the short to medium term. But I think student living could be a very interesting opportunity in tier two cities, simply because of the strategic value that organized co-living, student living players can bring to colleges, which may not have the best processes to service their students' needs, right? So that's something that we think is a need of the hour. And this is an area that we think, co-living operators can focus on from a tier two point of view.
That I think is very insightful, Pradeep, especially from an investment side. Sumit, do we have time? I think Rajesh... Rajesh Arora wanted to ask.
Yeah, he wants to ask.
Yeah, please go ahead.
And then we have a question from Hudko also in the chat box, if you want to take it up.
Okay, I'm trying to access.
Dr. Akshay Sen in the chat box. After Mr. Arora, please. Thank you.
Sure. Mr. Arora, go ahead, please.
And sir, you need to unmute yourself. Rajesh, sir, you need to unmute yourself. We can't hear you.
Yeah, is it okay? Can you hear
yes,
me now?
We can hear you loud and clear. I think screen is frozen now. Rajesh, sir, we can't.
Meanwhile, Sumit, can you just ask that question of Hudko? I'm not able to access that question.
Now you are.
Okay, I'm so sorry. Some network problem happened. Okay, my small question is to Mr. Arvind of Microsoft. how a company of that stature, of Microsoft, and of that size, can think of occupying a space in a co-working versus a leased premises? So this is my question addressed to Arvind. And my second question would be addressed to Anshul. So if I can ask him just a 1 minute later, then if Arvind could kindly help me with the reply.
Sure, Mr. Rajesh. Even if we are taking space from a co-working operator, those are actually exclusive space for us, sort of a built to suit sort of a requirement. So if you walk into any of our space that's provided by any of our operators today, it would look no different than our leased offices. So for an employee, if you recall my previous point, you know, we would want to not have any differentiation between whether it's an own solution or a lease solution or this co-working operating model. So these are exclusive space with our own corporate and security requirements. So for any employee, there would be no differentiation. So to answer your question, you know, the space helps us build that flexibility in our portfolio, but to an employee, it doesn't make a difference from an experience standpoint.
Oh, okay. Because, you know, why I said Microsoft, because, you know, I have the privilege of serving Microsoft when Rajiv Nair started Microsoft. I'm talking about the very first office in India. Nobody has heard of Microsoft. So that's why I said a company of your stature, you know, how can they occupy a co-working space versus a lease space? So you just answered beautifully.
The only exception was when we signed up our first enterprise deal for WeWork in India way back in 2017, about 500 seats. That was the only exception where we took a ready-to-market solution that was available. And that was primarily to win some new business into country. So I was very successful in doing that. We took about 500 seats and we also landed 500 headcount in that process. So very thankful to this model.
Where was that? I'm sorry, I missed it. Where was that?
It was the Galaxy in Bangalore.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you so much. Thank you for your reply. And if I could ask Anshul.
Is Anshul on the panel?
Is Anshul there?
No, I don't think so.
He's there.
He's not
okay.
There.
Oh, if anybody on the panel can, you know, address me. No, I'm talking from the audience point of view. For a minute, I'm not a panelist. So I'm asking from an audience point of view. You know, where the growth, like Anshul in his opening remarks said, the co-working has grown leaps and bounds in the last 2 to 3 years. So I would just like to have current information. Where have they really grown in Delhi NCR, if they have grown, secondly, how do we have adherence of these signed commitments by these co-working of what they have signed with the developers and landlords? Because there have been a lot of discrepancies and backing out of signed agreements of these co-working players with the owners and the developers. I'm sorry, but that is from the audience point of view or from the developer point of view, I'm asking. Okay, how do we ensure adherence to the signed agreements or whether payments of rentals, and or other adherence to the, you know, lease agreements and the lease commitments that the co-working players have done? Because when the things were going very good, they used to take a place on lease at 50 rupees, and then they used to take almost 3 times from the user. So when there was no COVID, they were taking best of that world. Now because of COVID, if they have lesser occupancy, they can't put all the damages on the owners.
Thank you, Rajesh ji. Krishna, just sorry to put you on a spot. I'm sure you guys are not doing the same because of you have a different approach on the managed spaces. But just as an industry, what's your thought on the question of Rajesh or Raji?
I think what Rajesh ji is referring to is the more generic co-working world where we had huge amount of operators coming in, anybody and everybody entering into this playing field, and there were I would assume there would be issues over that, which is very, very genuine, not in this industry, in every industry. But I would focus on the top players right now, and that's where the corporates are making a decision on whom they want to go with from a player perspective in terms of financial stability of the company, management capabilities, and your existing presence. It's a decision the client has to take with virtue of their due diligence so that the whole model is sustainable. And the same goes with landlords. Most of the landlords are now very, very selective on whom they want to have as the tenant, whom they want to lease out their spaces. So there is a due diligence happening at all aspects. Like we do our due diligence on the type of clients and the type of landlords from where we take the space. Same is happening, and that's where the good quality business is happening. There will always be outliers, Mr. Rajesh. But there is no one size fits all solution around here. And there is no answering for some other incident that have happened in other places. But a healthy business model is where the landlord, the operator, and the client all are doing their serious due diligence on the type of partnership that they're entering into. I think that's what is going to make this model more sustainable and more healthy in the long run.
Thank you, Krishna. Thank you. Sumit, I think I picked up that question, last question. The question from Dr. Akshaya Sen from UDCO is, from the quality of management of service provisions and maintenance point of view, which one would be better, owner-run co-living spaces or manager-run co-living spaces? So, Sriram, Dr. Nikhil, anyone would like to pick this up, or even Pradeep
this
wants
to
give
his... This is the last question of the day, right?
Yeah, and even Pradeep want to add anything on that.
Well, as Pradeep has said, it is operation intensive business. So whoever has the ability to operate, they are the ones who are going to win. So it really doesn't matter make a difference whether it's owner cum operator or operator manager driven business. So it really doesn't matter. So ultimately it depends on the ability to deliver the prompt services promised. And this, as I said earlier, this being localized business, so you'll have a lot of local heroes, just like in real estate development. So ultimately, the local heroes are the ones who will be able to manage the costs and deliver the services.
Sure.
Nikhil, you got anything to say?
As Sriram sir said, that if fundamentally one has to deliver a right experience, but design and practice and sort of technology investments that you can make skew the curve a little bit in terms of operators, because one owner for one property or two properties might find it hard to invest that much. But I think there is a sweet spot. Actually, one or two is a beautiful play, 1, 2, 3, 4. You don't need so much of technology to deliver a nice experience. Where it becomes 10, 20 is where the challenge will be. So owner-led properties, which are limited in number, owners will do a great job for sure, because the scale hasn't yet picked in to hamper the experience. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I don't know where that number lies. At some point, it will bite. And when you are talking about scaled operations, then obviously managers have a edge over there in terms of the sheer investments that they can afford to pump in for managing the experience.
And if I can add 2 cents, as long as the owner wants to create a lifestyle business that is extremely differentiated, you can kind of try and do it on your own, because this industry has a lot of incumbents. There is a certain price that exists in the market. And if you're not extremely differentiated in that, if you're not boutique-y, it'll be difficult for you to kind of match costs vis-a-vis the prices that exist in this market. So that's how I would ask Dr. Sen to kind of think about it.
Sure. I think very insightful, all three of you from the co-living side. Thanks again. Thanks everyone who were on the call today, patiently hearing the panel. I'm sure the panel members were able to add a lot of value to the knowledge, existing knowledge which you had, did some clarification on some of the points. And personally, me, I go much more knowledgeable on both the sides, having doing capital markets on from my side. So this will really help me in looking at both the businesses more seriously and differentiatedly. Some of the points which the panel members, I just want to leave a thought to everyone who's listening and the panel members who gave their thought process. Starting with Anshul spoke about great future globally for both these businesses, how global cities are doing post-pandemic about, especially about the rental housing and how some of the other rental housing is coming into the future. And then again, what the global view and global is happening, it'll get into India. Dr. Hiranandani spoke about student housing being one of the great rental housing opportunity as we move forward. Post-pandemic, people need to come back to offices, otherwise divorces will keep happening. So that's something which we heard from Dr. Hiranandani. Krishna spoke about, very well said, that businesses are there to manage their businesses, and this will keep happening in the future, which will entail great opportunity for managed spaces. And he said, it's not co-working, it's managed spaces, integrated solutions. And he also mentioned about technology moving forward, how it is going to play a big part in this particular segment. Arvind touched upon, you know, traditionally, you know, this business was more taking their own space, and the traditional model was going and occupiers taking their own space, because the plan was to do 5-year, 10-year perspective. But now, you know, the agility is very critical for an occupier, and the world is changing every month, leave alone 6 months or 12 months. And to forecast these changes, a co-working solution or integrated managed office solution is very critical as we move forward from a large occupier's perspective. Ritesh touched upon some of very paramount points on, you know, like safety is very paramount as we move forward from a developer perspective. Sustain, whatever we do, it has to be sustainable, and sustainability in on the office side or from the occupier side or even from a operator or a developer side is very critical of whatever asset class you choose or whatever you take a decision for. Nikhil touched about, you know, it's no more a co-living, it's a managed living. And he also said that they focused on few things like community-led offering, affordability, you know, those are very important points, deeper relationship with the asset partners, and then the technology evolution, which they are looking at. And among the 4-5 top operators, they're still only 2% market share. So they still have around 98% to look at. You know, Pradeep touched upon on the investment side, Pradeep touched upon, it's a vision business. You know, it's a business which has to be seen from a long-term perspective for an investor to come to. The investor has to invest ahead of its time. So they need to look at the credibility of the partner whom they are coming to, the long-term visibility of that partner, what is the exit route, what is their focus on customers. So those are bigger emphasis points which an investor will look at to invest in these asset classes. Sriram touched about, you know, government being very proactive during pandemic and post-pandemic from the regulation point of view, and he expects lot of you know, resolutions to come from government to make the rental housing much more attractive and moving forward. Also, he touched upon you know, moving forward, which city will attract will also depend on the migration and the workforce where it is going into. So some of these points which were, and Arvind also spoke about what I really liked. They are looking, you know, the moving forward is more leaner, meaner, and faster. So those are some of the points which I would like everyone to think about and go back to. And Rajesh ji very well summed up that it has to be a government, developer, and operator all working together as a win-win and repurposing a lot of existing real estate which is lying in all the cities, be it big city or a smaller city. Thank you, everyone. Thanks, everyone, again, from the panel members to give their extremely, you know, insightful thought process, and as well as very thankful to all the people who joined on the webinar today, and I hope we were able to add some value.
Saurabh, just last one request, if everyone can switch on their videos, please have to take a group photograph which we can use later on. Harshit, Arvind, Preeti, Lavin, if you all can do that, so that will help us.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very much for coordinating it so well, and it was a wonderful discussion. And
just have a, like one request to means I would like to thank all our partners, including Hiranandani Group and Tata Realty and Vesture, for you like and for their support in during this event. And a special thank to, of course, and Saurabh for leading this from the front. And we had a wonderful time with him and meet everyone, including like all the analysts for, of course, and bearing with us for means we are already exceeded our time by like almost in 30 minutes. And thank you everyone for staying back and answering all the questions possible. So once again, thank you very much. Thanks to all of you and for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sumit. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Saurabh did a wonderful job, and thanks, Sumit, for organizing it so well.
Thank you so much, Rajesh. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. And please take
all
care.
All the best.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Yeah. Be safe. Be blessed.
Thank you so much.